That's right. That's our intro music. Welcome to episode 100, people. We finally made 100! It. 100! This is take two of episode 100 since we really screwed it up. There was no audio, thanks to me and me being a moron. But you know what? We corrected that. We fixed it. And I blame Michael.
Hey.
There's no good reason.
Hey, I was here early. Thank you very much.
I know. We should have sound. I'm looking at OBS right now, Michael. It says we have sound. It says we have sound.
Sutherland says we have sound.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you, Sutherland. And we have video. We have a new layout. Everybody can check it out. This is, you know, we were going to do episode 100 right. We hopefully will have new intro music next week, or we're going to demo some music, because I haven't heard it yet. But one of the fans.
You don't want to just go with it blindly.
Yeah. Thank the Lord for sound. That's what I say, Mickey Worm. I'm completely seeing eye to eye on that one. All right, where did I don't even know where to start. Devin, you come back.
Yeah.
You came back to us. Child in hand.
Prodigal son, maybe. I'm glad to be back.
Thank you so much for coming back on episode 100. We were trying to get Eric, but Eric's microphone broke or something, and it's a hit and miss game. It's a hit and miss game, but I'm glad we could get you.
Same excuse you gave like 20 episodes ago.
It would have been perfect with the new layout too, huh? Because then you could have just gotten rid of the Xbox Uncut logo.
Get rid of the logo? So.
Wait a second. Can you just walk to the gas station and get some Dixie cups?
That was yeah.
Wow.
We haven't used that joke in a while. That's a thing.
Not going there, Devin.
Okay.
Look, I got some floss and some string to hook up to a USB port, but the man wouldn't do it. It's I forgot about the Dixie Cup joke. That's a throwback. But
I miss him.
Yes, we're going to have to get him on the podcast again. It's just... Well, let's talk about who we do have here. We have Michael. Welcome to the show, Michael.
Hey. Sorry about last week. Family was in town. Also my mother's birthday. So stuff is going on. But good to be back. And post E3 with all the insanity that happened there.
Yeah. We also have Mr. On Time Tim Dog.
What's up? How you doing?
Punctual Tim, as some people know.
100 episode. Glad to be here.
We have the one and only Vern. It's the Golden
Hello.
Throat.
The Golden Throat. Golden Throat. Yeah.
Very
I'm really
bearded,
digging this. Yes, I'm very bearded, just like Devin. We look the same now.
Yeah.
Related.
Surprisingly.
We do look related, kind of. I don't know. Maybe.
Like cousins, maybe, you know? Like
maybe just, cousins, yeah.
Yeah, cousins. Not immediate family, but... Somewhere
we definitely want. We're definitely trying to be like each other if we're not related.
Yeah, I
I'm
saw
this
on
new
the,
layout
on the podcast once, and I just decided to change my whole look.
Yeah, but I'm digging this new look. You know, it's kind of fun. I can turn to my right and I'm looking at Jason, and I can look up at Tim. You know, I can do one of these like far-reaching looks to the right. I see Dustin. You know, it's really cool.
Hey man, got to do what you got to do. We also
I'm
have
like
Jason
Sauron,
on the
I
show.
Am from above, my mighty eyes.
I'm gonna
sing all of you.
I can move you.
It's don't
like
move me.
Like I said, like I said in chat, Patton will just be slowly judging Vern the entire set.
Yeah, actually, you're kind of looking past me.
Am I? Oh, okay.
Yeah, you're looking off like, into the distance. Just
he's
like
gonna be I've... slowly judging chat the entire.
What is chat? It's doing pile of shit that it is.
Hey, not cool. Not cool.
Not our chat. Awesome. The majority of Twitch chat. Let me amend that statement.
Our chat is amazing.
Yeah, our chat's the bomb.
You know why? Because we didn't get any letters this week.
What?
We didn't, which is very disappointing. I wanted letters, damn it. We got not a single friggin' letter. And I blame Jason for telling people that letters.xboxuncut.com doesn't exist more, and it does. It is there.
True.
You can go to letters@xboxuncut.com and write us and be like, hey, Vern, there's this girl and I don't know what to do. Help me out. Like
that's just
true.
Not controversial enough.
Look, if you want to talk about Gamersgate, you could go to another podcast because we're done with that. Like, I'm sorry.
You got to be more edgy.
Yeah. Well, look, Tim, that's why we brought you on the show.
Wow. I got in trouble for being edgy.
No,
Matrix.
No, you didn't get in trouble. You didn't get in trouble. Let's be clear about that.
Now, if only you would finish introducing other people that are on the show.
Well, I'm sorry, and we have Steve Rules.
Hey, guys. Episode 100.
Our international correspondent.
National correspondent?
I said international
correspondent. International.
He tells us what's going on the other side of the pond.
Yeah.
I could be like, hey, Tim. I don't know. It was bad joke. It was riveting radio. That's what we're doing here. But we did get... I got a message from Obi Wang on Xbox Live apologizing that he could not write in fast enough. And he wanted to send us a message anyway. But I couldn't send it to Vern in time, so I'm just going to read it myself. It's usually Vern's segment. I want to apologize to Vern.
I have another segment upcoming anyway.
Yeah, you do. And I haven't been here for a week, so I got to do it like twice or something. I don't know. Like, it's I feel off. Hey, Dustin. I'm probably too late to email the show. Just wanted to congratulate you and the boys on 100 episodes. Massive achievement, and wish you all the best for the next 100.
Are you expecting another 100?
I am. I'm gonna replace you all.
Fan.
All of you.
Like, you know, the question should be: we gonna do only another 100? You know, I mean,
I like that.
Best Xbox podcast by miles. Keep up the good work, guys. Obi Wang.
Suck it. Podcast unlocked.
Thank you, Obi. We haven't had Phil Spencer on yet, so.
I know, we need that.
No, but that's talking to, you know, I'm not guaranteeing.
You guys all want
but
Phil Spencer.
Wait a second. Our good friend Southbound that was on the show said he might be able to help us out. Get one of the Gears of War guys to come on the show.
I want
Which one?
That'd be nice.
I got to pull up his name. I'm sorry.
Can we get Josh?
No, I can't use that. Josh.
Name. Is it Josh? All yes, Josh. Yeah.
I want to get Thank Dan Greenewalt on the show so we can finish this beard thing.
I think we all have to try to grow beards, even if we can't.
Yeah.
If he comes on the show, though.
Even if
Michael,
do you
just always have a baby face, or can you grow facial hair?
I can grow facial hair that, at best, is like 4 or 5 centimeters long.
You have to Sharpie it on if you can't.
The thing is, I have like maybe 20 hairs total that will grow here. It's terrible. I have
so you're a baby
fucking
face.
Baby face.
Just fill in the holes.
Like
damn my genetics. all this German and this Dutch and this Swiss.
But yes, one day we'll have a beard cast. It'll be a good day.
That'd be nice.
All right, well. I guess we should just get right into news then.
Did we introduce everyone yet?
I said Steve.
Everyone that matters.
Jason. Yeah.
Chat on. Whoever doesn't matter.
All right.
Yeah,
good.
Unless I got to introduce myself. I mean, I'm Dustin.
Yeah, introduce
you
yourself.
What?
Yeah.
If you don't. What's awesome now with our new layout is you see people's Twitter handles right under their faces now. You see their
That's
names.
Really cool.
You see the Xbox Live names? And I didn't even ask Devin, but I put his Twitter up there, and the only thing Devin has on his Twitter are links to videos from his Xbox account.
That's not the only thing, but mostly.
I scrolled through. Like, it's like 99%. Maybe his first tweet was like, hey, like, just Xbox
I
link.
I tweeted Phil Spencer and Xbox a couple times about... A couple different things.
But what were they?
I was
he wanted
to
know about Gamersgate. He needed to know Gamergate.
It's not
and...
Gamersgate. No. No, it's
not Gamersgate. Phil, can you explain Gamersgate to me?
I'm sure he'd love to answer that.
Actually, Gamersgate is a PC
is the,
distributor.
It is. Gamergate is the actual
movement.
Hashtag. Yeah.
I'm sorry. They're going to come after me now.
Nope.
I can. You're just not too far away. All right. Well, let's get into news.
Please.
Fallout 4 will run at 1080p and 30 frames per second on every console. Asterisk, PCs can run it whatever the hell they feel like.
Are you sure? Because people got pretty mad about that.
Look, God. Bethesda came out and said that Fallout 4 is 1080p, 30 frames per second on the Xbox One and PS4. Resolution and frames per second are not limited in any way on the PC. So, Bethesda says it's true. Maybe.
So Iron Galaxy isn't doing the PC port.
Yes, that is true. It's confirmed.
Too soon, Van. Too soon.
Eat that dead horse.
It's not a dead horse yet, because Steam's keeping it alive. So go ahead and pre-order it and return it, and that way they lose more money. But...
I don't think this is really a surprise. I mean, honestly, it looks good, but it doesn't look something that couldn't be 1080p 30. I mean, does anyone think that? I mean,
yeah, I wasn't surprised. I mean, the thing is that Microsoft have always said, you know, from the Xbox One perspective, Microsoft have always, you know, they had this sort of slide from the early Xbox One years and talked about sort of SRAM usage. And how, you know, they'll get to 1080p in, at like the end of the second full year and stuff. So, and it's Microsoft marketed, and games that have that seem to run better than games that aren't. So it's not a big surprise.
I think you can just look at the game and tell it's probably going to be 1080p, 30 frames per second, though.
Or at least hope it will be.
Yeah, it doesn't look like it's doing anything crazy as far as the graphics are concerned. All the systems, that's another story, you know. But
I think, I was telling some other people this, but I think that the biggest thing that we're going to see this generation when it comes to open world games, at least, isn't going to be like a huge difference in graphics per se, but I think games are just going to get more dense. You know, I mean, you're just going to have more things in them. Like foliage and things like that. Just a lot more there. And I can already see, I don't know if I'm allowed to say this, I can already see the difference in Fable Legends beta. I'm not going to talk about it because I don't want to get banned. But
well, you can talk about what you've
it's
seen.
It's extremely dense.
You can talk about what you've seen in the E3 videos and trailers and things like that. So.
Bit of a wink-wink, nod-nod.
Yeah. Exactly. It's extremely, extremely dense, and you really realize that, especially when you're walking around on your own and just looking at all the details. So
you mean when you watch someone walk around?
Exactly.
Okay.
Yes. You watch someone walk around.
To be honest, though, this is to be expected. Like, what you're talking about, the density of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you think about how the big thing about Killer Instinct was all of those particle effects, right?
Yeah.
Because of how quickly they were developing the game, and, you know, because it was made in like a year, right, initially, the engine and everything, they decided to focus on one thing that's really big and impressive and flashy, and that's big explosions of particles, right? Mm-hmm. Which, granted, looks really cool, and they've used it to great effect with our characters. You know, Eryptor's flames, those are particles. Conrad's sand is particles, all that sort of stuff. It's to be expected. And it seems like they went all out on foliage with Fallout 4, which makes sense. Boston wasn't bombed as heavily. It had like one bomb dropped on it, so 200 years later, it's feasible that it would come back up a little bit. And like, you definitely notice this, like at the beginning of the demo where they're walking down, he walks past a river, and you just see plants. You see the rocks through the water because it's like crystal clear and stuff. So. Mm-hmm. They're definitely focusing on different things, and this is to be expected because as people start out with a piece of hardware, they figure out what they can do really well and then work with that, and then they figure out how to do everything else really well because you want something out eventually. So I'd imagine, you know, they're probably going to get an Elder Scrolls out by this console generation end,
toward the end. Yeah,
that you'll probably see at 60 because they'll be used to the thing by then.
You see The Witcher as well. The Witcher 3 is a good example of density. I mean, detail everywhere. And when you walk up to a river, now it looks like this could probably be what a river would look like in real life. I know that actually is. I'm an outdoors kind of person. But
we've never seen rivers.
Last gen, though, it was like you have this. You have this really sterile looking. You know. You have this Forza looking. landscape.
Oh, God. Oh.
And just water. And, you know, it just didn't look as believable. But you had, like, little tiny things of grass, you know, here and there. But now, this gen, I mean, they've really ramped up the density, and it's much appreciated.
Devin, I found out.
I think that alone is worth it.
I found out pretty quickly arguing with people that apparently I'm the only one that's ever seen bright colors in real life, so.
Yeah, my brother's a professional photographer, by the way. Nobody else is going to get this, but he was laughing pretty hard.
At the whole thing?
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's like, people just don't understand. they just don't understand.
Context is important, gentlemen.
I think this game's probably going to look like one of the remasters we see nowadays on console. It's going to look very clean, but it's not going to be anything that looks extremely impressive, which is fine.
It started cross-gen.
Yeah. Yeah, it does.
The two things is density and then mechanics. And you're just going to have a lot more things that you're going to be able to do. And the one was like the town building thing, you know, and then putting your guns together. I mean, it's going to be really cool. And not just for Fallout, but like for all games this generation, I think all open world games, you're just going to have more density and more game mechanics. I don't necessarily think that at least on the consoles, we're going to be seeing completely mind-blowingly beautiful games, you know, where the graphics just completely wow you. I think maybe towards the end of it, in smaller games, but not in big open-world games.
I will say...
I'd love to be proven wrong, but we'll see.
I've been playing The Witcher this week, and yeah. I think it looks stunning. I do.
It does.
You know, no matter where you are, like, because like, it does a quite good job of, you know, changing up the landscape, so you know you have like all the forests and then the towns and then like the city and stuff. And I think no matter where you are, it just looks fantastic. Like, I'm often in awe at it.
It does absolutely look stunning. But if you go up and look at like each piece of foliage, you can definitely tell that it's completely fake. You know, but what makes it believable, what tricks your brain is, yeah, what makes it believable and tricks your brain is that it's so dense. Everything's so dense, and so your brain just doesn't even see anything pixelated. You know, it doesn't see any bad textures. You know, it sees this whole picture that your brain's putting together. And I mean,
that's how any game will work, though. You put a focus on any one thing, and you're going to notice how shitty it is. Like, yeah. You stand behind a wall in Destiny, and you go, oh, that's terrible. But if you're moving too quickly, it doesn't really matter. The issue with that, with you saying, oh, we're going to see new mechanics, is it's not so much a function of new hardware, it's a function of new ideas. Because stuff like the base building, that's existed before. It's just, it's difficult to do because you have to plan it out. And like the custom weapon creation, that definitely has been done before. Look at the Ghost Recon games, especially Ghost Recon Future Soldier. Go look at that. You're talking, you could make a gas, you could have gas systems, you could do barrel types, you could have all this sort of stuff. And in comparison, the Fallout 1 looks kind of limited, but it's not because it completely changed weapon performance versus Ghost Recon, which was a bit more realistic in how it affected performance, but definitely density, definitely texture quality, definitely, you know, little things. Yeah. Like I said, like particles, lighting, all that sort of stuff.
Lighting is going to be a big one. Lighting is going to improve a lot over this generation.
Yeah, I think that's where The Witcher, like, even if the textures themselves, we look up close, aren't so good. Like, the lighting is what makes that good, and like how it captures like all the different weather effects and that sort of thing.
No, but what The Witcher does really well, and I don't know why we're talking about The Witcher, but what The Witcher does outstanding is you'll see the fog of war in The Witcher. It is there, but you'll see the outlines to just like a building, and it's just this huge thing at the end of the ocean. And the way they do the atmosphere is amazing. It looks awesome. You want to go and explore and be like, what is that thing in the distance? Like, what? Because you're on the ocean, the sun will just be coming up, the lighting's hitting it just right, and how they hide the fog of war into the lighting is really, really amazing. Especially in the open world parts, when you're looking at stuff that's real far away. I mean, that's how I always thought that's what the best part of that game was, seeing like a lighthouse at the top of a hill, and you're just like, I want to explore that. Like, it's all broken, but I want to go and explore that. That's what makes The Witcher so amazing.
The best looking
smart
games,
patient development.
The best looking games are going to be the games that deal with LOD the best, honestly. Whatever game deals with level of... Every game has a level of detail, but whichever one deals with it best is going to honestly be the most immersive and best-looking game, especially yeah. open world.
It's going to be less jarring.
I think animations are also getting extremely important, because that's yeah. the thing that pulls me out of The Witcher's end presentation, since we're talking about that. I mean, everything looks amazing in that game except the animations and transitions from animation to animation, so... I think that's incredibly important as well. But I imagine that's a budget concern. Like, I think if The Witcher had, like, doubled the budget, maybe that wouldn't be something we'd even be talking about, so.
Jason, you're getting a hum, by the way.
Hum. Okay. I'm sorry.
All right. Well, let's move on to E3 2015. Forza Motorsport 6 will let you play as a woman.
Yeah,
it's a big improvement on the series for a game that you could only see the person's hands. But now you're going to be able to see female hands instead of just male hands. I like the big story was, you know, oh, it's allowing equality. And yes, it does. It's awesome. I just hope it means that the story mode, you're going to actually have a person now that is driving all these cars. And you'll actually, because they've been talking about a career, like a brand new career, so it'll be cool to see if they have almost a character creation in the game. I don't know. You never know.
Yeah, that'd be nice, yeah.
Like, I could just see, like, actually having a drivatar, you know? Not, like, it's not just what you do, it's who you are. Like, that'd be really cool. But, I mean, yes, we know. You only see, they're all in helmets in Forza, and you're wearing a fireproof suit, so you really don't see anything. But it's an option, you know?
The most important part of this is boobs. And that's about it. Because that's the only way you're going to tell someone in a thick
in trouble.
Racing suit. That's the only way you're going to tell someone in a thick racing suit's a woman. And that's about it.
No, that's not true. You can see the hands with the nails.
No, they got hair. Wow. You might see some hair coming out of the helmet.
Yes, Tim. Women are going to have fingerless gloves.
Actually, you wouldn't see the hair coming out of it, because it would be you could catch your hair on fire. You would tuck your hair in the suit. Like
a bun. It'll be in a bun.
A professional racer. No.
But maybe she has like a pink racing outfit on.
Maybe you like do a three-dimensional bun.
Say that a man can't wear a pink racing outfit.
Yeah, what's wrong?
He's less likely to.
But, you know, it's nice that they're giving the option. I don't think anybody's disagreeing with it.
If I had the option, I would probably put a pink outfit on my guy, though. I gotta say.
So. I think the farthest this is probably going to go is it's probably going to be connected to your drivatar, so when you're racing, someone could tell whether or not you identify as a woman or a man, and that's about it.
No, but I would think it'd be cool in Forza if you like you could pick your sex, but then you could also pick. All right, this dude's being banned.
Yeah, first troll. You go for a PC Master Race. I agree with you.
Are you going to see your character walk around your car and get in?
I don't know. At the beginning of the race, like you see what is it? Pit guys at the beginning of a race. So maybe you see your person get in the vehicle. Like maybe that's I think that's what you're gonna end up seeing. Yeah, but I think it'd be really cool if they had like you had a jacket and you could pick like badges that go on your jacket. That'd be pretty awesome. Like just customize it so your drivatar is actually a little bit more personal. And since
I'd imagine they'd make a bigger deal out of that if you were going to like an E3.
You still got Gamescom.
Very true. Very true. Yeah, and Gamescom's gonna be like 4 weeks before the game comes out. So
yeah,
it'd be a good time to announce it. Get people keep it in mind with people.
Well, I could tell you as far as BadNet is concerned, who's pretty much the Forza insider. We're going to be getting a lot more Forza information regularly, so in the coming
week. This week, he said, right?
Yeah, this week. So very, very soon. So if you're interested in that kind of thing, just keep your ears open. You'll be seeing a lot more. I think someone already said, it's to the point we're so close right now, they could announce 3 cars a day. So we're going to get some cool stuff.
We did get some other Forza news this week. Is that also in the news?
No, the
bundle.
No, I didn't put the bundle in there. No, I figured we'd talk about it when we did this. So,
okay.
Yeah.
Tell us about the bundle, Steve.
Steve, what's going on?
It is a very special, custom, limited edition. Actually, I'm not sure this is limited. Forza 5 bundle.
I think it is limited.
Yeah, they've got like a special blue trim, and they've got like stuff to commemorate the anniversary. There's a nice blue controller. Comes with digital code, 1 terabyte console. Comes with a like a DLC pack for sort of 10-year anniversary of the franchise.
The racing stripes are freaking awesome. I have to say it again. It looks awesome.
Well, so, the audio
sound thingies.
Yep. Yeah. Yep. So, like with most of their custom consoles, it makes like car noises when you press the on and off button and the disc eject button. So they've really gone all out for this bundle, and that's $399. So that's on same day as the game. So
that controller was pretty sweet. I liked how it had the diamond grip underneath, the same as the Elite controller.
I wonder if that's going to become something common going into the future. Maybe even the standard controller will adopt a diamond grip.
That'd be nice.
Yeah, maybe it would
for
be.
Special edition controllers.
Yeah, probably.
Well, I was thinking like maybe a year or two down the road. Not tomorrow.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Ford can dream, guys.
Yes, I can.
Just let him dream.
Uh-huh. But, I mean, this bundle kind of came out of nowhere for me. I mean, you know, I wasn't expecting it. So, I mean, it's cool they're doing it, but
I would have expected this at E3. Yeah.
I think it's just a limited edition thing. They probably didn't make that many of them just to promote Forza, and then they'll probably move on to something else in October, like a Halo bundle, you know?
I think you guys are forgetting the best thing about this news is that they finally sold all the black consoles so they could start making the limited edition ones that look different. So they're not stockpiling black consoles anymore.
It's mainly the Assassin's Creed consoles that they're finally gotten rid of, it seems, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
Because I'm noticing on Amazon now in the bestsellers listings, it looks like the Halo one's about to pass up the Assassin's Creed one. So I'm assuming that one's about to run out. So that's probably a good thing.
Sweet.
Yeah.
I'm just excited for the new career mode in Forza because I know people love it, but I feel kind of disjointed with Forza games because you jump in and it's you pick the league you want to be in. It's just too open. Like I kind of want a more structured.
Horizon 2 had a bit of structure compared to Forza Motorsport 5, I think. So if it's closer to that, I think I'd be happy.
Zorb said, "Can't wait to see Phantom Dust at Gamescom." Crying, it's like, yeah. I don't think we talked about it, but Phantom Dust is not canceled. It's just not an active development.
They just don't have anyone to work on it.
Really stinks.
Maybe they'll kickstart it.
No.
No. Too soon? Too soon.
People would actively hate them for that.
Oh, man.
Why would a multi-billion-dollar company need to kickstart an IP?
Look, sometimes you just gotta. They need to gauge the interest in Phantom Dust, okay? That's all they're doing. They're just gauging it, touching it, stroking it, maybe? All right.
With a forklift?
Yeah, pretty much. Just don't ask for more than 5 mil or they're going to can you. But let's move along. Let's talk about Kinect is required for Katana on Xbox One.
For what? Oh,
Rage.
Cortana. I thought you said
Rage.
Katana.
Cortana. I'm sorry. Did I say Katana?
You said Katana.
Okay. Well, I
was going to say.
Katana.
It's like a New York accent version.
Yeah.
I was thinking this is a new game that I haven't heard of.
Now, the only reason I think this is all right, even though I still think they should give you the option with a microphone, is that one thing we've learned since the launch of the Xbox One is that there's nothing more annoying than when someone leaves their mic open and gives commands. And the only way to give commands, if you have a headset on, using the headset would to leave it open. So every time you gave
Xbox
a command,
go to everyone blah, blah, blah. Would have to like, hear shut it. Up.
Shut Doesn't up. It revert to the Kinect, though?
No, if you what? Mute your no. microphone and you say, Xbox, go wherever, it'll just do it and nobody has to hear you say really? It.
That's
it's,
awesome.
It's a common courtesy. But
the new headsets, they don't have the adapter where you can easily do it with your thumb. Don't you have to, like, grab the...
That's true.
Yeah. Mm.
But so, the new Dash, it looks like it's going to be quicker to pop over.
Yeah.
To mute it. Which is... It's going to be more...
Well, what I meant is that if you didn't... In a situation where you didn't have a Kinect at all, so if you were just using a microphone to give it commands, you would have to have it unmuted to give commands. So yeah. Every single time you gave a command, people would have to hear you. And it is actually really annoying when you're trying to have a conversation.
I'd be because... fine with my Astros. I could just lift them up, I think.
Yeah. No. The second you mute it, you wouldn't be able to give commands because the mic's muted. I don't think
well,
it does.
I meant through Kinect.
Through your Kinect. Yeah.
Well, that's
if you have a
I was
Kinect,
thinking about what you said about the new controllers not having the adapter. And...
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I was thinking, okay. Well, I could just flip
but,
it up.
No, you're right, but the Astro A50, like, Astros are the only headsets that allow you to do that. Like, Turtle Beach don't.
Yeah.
There is no mute button on a Turtle Beach headset. All right. Well, that's, you know, it is a controversy.
Yeah, the good stuff.
Cortana. I didn't say Katana. Cortana allows, you know, is a server-based algorithm. It's not on your console. It doesn't need Kinect to process the language or words or anything. It's all in the cloud.
Hmm. Right. So it could be done.
Yeah.
Oh, could be done.
I think it should be.
Yeah.
I just want the option so when my
Kinect
is on.
Yeah, I think it probably should. If they can do it,
Well,
more options are better, so...
Well, the base SKU that people are going to be buying doesn't include Kinect at this point.
Exactly.
I mean, you know, exactly.
I think Kinect is convenient. I do. And I think that if people who want to get it, go out and get it. You know, I think if they go out and get it, it'll prove itself if they really like it. But, if you buy it and then you don't like it, then you're going to have to end up selling it. Most people probably won't take the time to sell it, though. They'll just end up angry at it and then creating more internet hate.
You know what I say? Fuck them. But I just hope they allow us to make it so if the Kinect is attached, the voice recognition always goes through the Kinect and not the headset. Because I don't want it to go through the headset. Because I have a Kinect on every one of my Xboxes. And that's how I want it to stay. But I see them doing it right if they're going to do it in first place. Like, if they make it so you can use it over the headset, it's going to be done right and not a cheap gimmick. Like, it's not going to be a quick fix. They're going to do it right.
I see them. I don't see no reason that they won't eventually add just support for the microphone to do it. It's probably just a Kinect thing to start off with because that's just where they're at with it. I don't, like, after, like, it doesn't seem like they're trying to make a huge push for the Kinect anyway, so I don't see why they'd have any kind of reason to make it Kinect only for into the future.
I think that it's kind of one of those things where, you know, they'll get to it. I mean, I've always thought that they'll add, like, a dongle or something to it that's got, like, a microphone in it, so you don't have the camera, but you can have the voice commands or even over the microphone, but it's just one of those things that, you know, they're doing so many other things that they just don't have time for right now, and they'll get
they're busy
to it,
with,
like, next
backwards
year or
compatibility.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then, like, from a hardware perspective, you know, they're making the new controller and all that
sort
of thing. Yeah, so it's just, you know, they're just, you know, there's only so many things they can do.
Now, we don't have this specifically in the news, but there was a podcast that just came out not too long ago with an interview with Phil Spencer on Podcast Unlocked on IGN. And there was something very interesting that I took away from it. Microsoft, well, Phil Spencer said there are more third-party Kinect games in active development as of right now.
Just Dance.
No, that's true, but he didn't say first party.
No.
He specifically said third party.
That's true.
Yeah, well, they've had some indie games as well. I know that I don't have anything to my mind to hand, but there are a few indie games coming that are so-and-so for Kinect. So, you know, they're still pushing that, because I think that there's actually probably a larger market than you think on Xbox One of making Kinect games. There's a bigger market for people that will necessarily buy that game just because it's Kinect.
It's just that you don't hear that online. You hear the toxicity. Yeah.
But it's something that's not developed with a huge budget in mind. That's, so it can be sort of successful to a sort of group. I mean, here you go. There's a game here called Squid Hero for Kinect.
Right. The person that's going to go and buy these games isn't going to post on a hardcore gaming message board. It's just
Exactly. The thing that they get in trouble with, though, is when they do it, people start shouting, oh, you spent money on that when you could have been spending money on a hardcore game that we want to play,
Well, there'll always be
crazy. I don't worry about it. It's just that's what happens. And I'm just trying to think how Microsoft is thinking. And I know one thing that Phil Spencer said I think he was apologizing for the stuff that happened when they announced the Xbox. One thing that he said that one thing that's really important to us from now on is that we get your permission for everything that we do. And he said, I think we need to earn it. I think we need to earn your permission to do different things and to try different things. And I think the best way that they can do that is through indie games and Kinect. If they want to get really, help support Kinect, the best way they can start earning people online anyway, and I know that's who he was talking to, because not everybody's going to listen to that, but people online, I think the best way to do it is through indie games, because they're going to see that, and they're going to be like, okay, not a lot of money was spent on that, so it's okay.
Well, the thing is they have to walk a really tight rope, because they've gone through it so far, like in the past half a year, Microsoft's done a very good job of not doing anything controversial. We went through E3 and there wasn't a huge backlash. There hasn't been anything for people to make a stink about. And we're walking a very tight rope not to do that, because the online community right now, I don't know what, well, I guess I do know what it is, but it's just, you do anything at all and they will have a fit.
Yeah.
So, I think
more against Microsoft than the competitors.
Let's be fair here. Well, not even fair here. Sony talked about TV on their stage. I haven't seen a single game thing about.
Well, so. No, I brought that up. That was dumb by that. I think anybody in today, if you didn't learn your lesson, 2 years, three, even a year ago, you shouldn't have that on the E3 floor. And that was a big no-no. I mean, people noticed that. I don't think that was smart by them, but I don't think it's ever going to be done again either. I actually talked about that today, so.
I don't follow Sony's side of anything. Did the online community blow up about the TV on their stage?
They were defending it. A lot of the Xbox guys were, because we know TV, 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 we remember that, so. A lot of the Xbox community was talking about it, but it was definitely, to be honest, I think it's just, it's a momentum killer. That conference Sony had was good, but I felt that there was no reason for that TV hue or whatever it was to be in there. They should just have that on a separate event, because that's all, it just opens up a can of worms. And we know how it is, as Xbox fans, when the TV, 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 TV thing came out.
Exactly.
You forgot it's not... sports.
Yeah.
NFL, TV, TV, NFL, whatever.
It seems like they get a pass quite a bit more than Microsoft does. And I think, I don't think that's fair at all. Microsoft should get passes to try new things as well. That's what Phil Spencer was talking about, when he said, what he did about I think we have to earn it. If we do so many good things, then we have permission to do one crazy thing that we don't know is going to work. I think PlayStation saw that they had all these cool things that everybody's so freaking out about and so amazing that okay, we can fit this TV in there, and it won't be so bad.
I think that Sony, I think that, you know, I don't necessarily say this is how other people feel here, but I think Sony have earned, with the way that they have responded to that community, the right to spend sort of a few minutes about non-game stuff and kind of get away with it. I mean, you know, if you're a big PlayStation fan, that conference was probably sort of your biggest dream with the sort of things that they showed. So I think, you know, with the other things that they showed, you know, big things, not anything for this year, but that's probably why they kind of got away with it without mention, because people were so busy, you know, talk about Horizon and, you know, them sort of three things like The Last Guardian.
Steve, I don't agree.
Were a PlayStation fan?
If Microsoft could have sold, even at past E3s where they didn't even show TV, they still got criticized for selling TV because it happened at their reveal event. Even for last E3 where they didn't even show any, I still see people bringing up how last E3 was it was only TV at the Microsoft E3 show. It's not because they revealed big things at their show. It's because it's Sony, and that's just the way the community is right now.
I mean, I don't know about it being a Sony fan's biggest dream, because just Last Guardian, but Final Fantasy's coming to Xbox probably, most likely, and then Shenmue
is a better name.
Shenmue Kickstarter.
Yeah, that was on Xbox, and the only way as a PlayStation fan that you can be happy about that is because you're happy that Xbox fans don't get to play it. I mean, I wouldn't be happy
That's a weird thing, actually, because you figure the people who were really in the Shenmue 1 and 2, they own Dreamcast. And most Dreamcast users I know, when they think of the PlayStation 2, they think, that's the console that killed Dreamcast.
Yeah.
And a lot of that group of people moved over to Xbox, and that's why Shenmue 2 ended up on Xbox, part of the reason, I think. So, it is kind of weird, but at the same time, it's been so long since then, and Sony has such a stronger foothold in Japan than something like Xbox, which has none. So, I mean, I can see that relationship happening. It makes sense in that light. But,
and I hate to say, when that game eventually does come out, 3/4 of its sales are going to be to people that have no fucking idea what Shenmue was.
And they're going to hate it.
Yeah. Like, they're not going to
if it's anything like the original, they'll hate it.
They'll understand that there's hype behind it.
I mean, you know.
They're not going to get 10 million.
They'll be lucky to get the 5.
Well, they said if the 5 is not even going to be open world, right?
Yeah.
No, for open world, it's 10.
It's 5. It's
so crazy.
It's pretty much dead now as far as the movement with the funding right now. It more so than even, like, I would say, Eulalie was, it feels like. So.
As with the majority of the stuff that Sony showed, it was big, immediate hype. And then nothing. Whereas Xbox fans, from the day of the conference, had backwards compatibility, and every month were getting new stuff to play with.
Yep.
Exclusive new stuff that is out this year. That isn't out in 2016 or 2017 or 2018. It's out this year.
Look, there's only one thing that matters. All right,
yeah.
There's one
Michael's
thing.
Going for
it. Yeah.
And that's me and Vern have both been there. It's Hexic HD. Right there, it's a game changer. It's on the Xbox One now.
One thing that they announced everybody knows about it, the Elite Controller. But I thought it was pretty ironic that was announced exactly at the same time that the COD partnership was lost. And if any of you guys are any like pro gamers, I was very competitive in COD. And I know for a fact that these guys are not going to want to move over to a different controller. I mean, they are going to be ticked that they're going to have to move over to a different controller. And then the Elite Controller, you know, I mean, that's a pro player's wet dream, this awesome new controller.
I think that depends on whatever the series that runs competitive Call of Duty, whatever that the organizer is going to depend on them.
They have hinted at a changeover, but I don't think they've announced it yet as well. So I think
Xbox
thing is Microsoft
used to fund them.
Yeah, Microsoft funded it, so they're not going to do that anymore. And Activision Activision have kind of hinted at this and said, you know, we'll do what we have to make it work. So I wouldn't be surprised if there was kind of a bit of an issue with how Microsoft was so involved in it, and then they step away from it, and everyone's like, mm-hmm.
"Who's going to give these prizes out now?
How come it's
now?
Not the same quality? How come?" Yeah, I can totally see that.
Who's going to actually, you know, spend millions of dollars to have cash prizes for people?
Sony has with Street Fighter.
They probably will.
Sony has honestly strong-armed Microsoft out of competitive fighting games with Street Fighter V. Doing that, they basically shove the Xbox out of the way as a competitive console.
Yeah, but with that, it's just not going to be the same. I mean, these people...
Not as easily,
you're really
least.
In love with your controller. You really are. You're, like, at one with your controller, and... Even people that are trying to get into the competitive scene, you know, and then for the elite controller to come along, I mean, it's what you would, it's just what you've always wanted, you know, if you're a competitive.
And cheaper.
If COD players have to play on PS4, I think what's going to happen is they're all going to buy scuff controllers. So
yeah,
I imagine that's going to have to happen.
Controllers are terrible.
I know, but I wouldn't be surprised if a market grows for that if they do have to play on PS4.
Even if it does grow, it's still a different controller. It's like a different stick layout and everything.
They might just make a brand new one from scuff that is like the Xbox one, but works on PS4. I wouldn't be surprised. I mean,
the Shalit?
Yeah.
That's
the Sony Elite.
I just thought it was funny that the Elite controller was announced at the same time the COD partnership was lost. I don't really care about COD anymore. I gave too much of my life to that game. But
yeah.
I just thought
I could tell you, that controller, I actually had hands-on at it at E3. It's really nice. It really is. I mean, I don't like spending $150 for a controller because you're going to pretty much, if you spend a little bit more, you can get like a console like the Wii U. But you're pretty much forced into it. I mean, it really is. It's well made. It's the
how
box.
Heavy is it?
Very, very.
I've heard
heavy.
It's heavier. Yeah,
heavy.
It has steel in it, of course.
In a good way, though. Did you like that it felt heavy?
I felt like it was really strong. Yeah, it felt like it's really heavy. That's why I remember that was like, wow.
We throw this controller, we should be worried about our walls.
Yeah, it'd probably go through the wall.
Did the triggers feel the same?
The triggers are different because you could have a high stick placement where it just like it's really cool. You take the stick off, and you could drop a small, a lower sized stick, or you can go a high stick, and you could do that for both sticks depending on how you like it. I like I think there's three sets. There's small, medium, and then there's like a long. It's a elongated stick. It's really high up. So you can change. It's interchangeable. It's really nice. I mean, and my favorite thing is the disc plate for the D-pad. It's customizable. So like if you get like I'm getting a Forza 6 one sent to me. From a guy I met from L.A. because he
got
one.
I want the Gears one.
Yeah, the Gears one.
Gears
one is
awesome.
It's so nice. I had the choice between the two, but I like the Forza one better. But yeah, it's so nice. It really is. It's
my question about the triggers, though, what I was talking about. You know how they have like little kind of diagonal edges on the outsides of them?
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm talking about? Is that still there, or is
it
a little smoother?
I didn't really check it. It looks like it's modified to what the new controller specifications are. Like the bumper is definitely different. The LB,
yeah.
RB.
How'd you like the bumpers? The new bumpers.
I liked it. Like I said, I don't have it. I was really impressed with the Elite. I mean, I saw it, and it's the way it comes packaged too. It's really nice. You know, you get the disc, and then you get the D-pad, and then you get the three sets of the high, low, and medium.
Did you have to try out the different lengths for the sticks or not?
Yes, I like it with the high on the left side of the stick placement, and the one in the middle. I like the small. So I felt like you know he was telling me the guy who actually he was the vendor I guess who was giving me some information. And then, obviously, the things in the back, the little flippers, are very cool. If you could switch it on and off, and you could switch two configurations too. So if you have one, it's totally customizable. They're going to have an app where you can completely set up the controller how you want. I mean, I don't get into it that much, but for the hardcore gamer, it's a complete win. I mean,
probably nice for MMOs too.
Yeah, it's really nice. Even for like driving with those things, I think they're the scuff parts, the where in the middle of the control. I don't know what the flippers are. I guess they're
called. Well, yeah, you could use them for shifting if you wanted.
Yeah. I mean, you can make whatever you want. You can make the L trigger the B button. You know, it's completely customizable.
Right.
If it was $99, $100, I get two. I feel like that's like the real price point for it. I think the 150 is a little excessive, but it's kind of hard not to not want it after having it. I'm getting it. You know what I mean?
So the price point is perfect.
What do you think?
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah.
I just don't like the fact that I can pretty much maybe get a Wii U on sale for.
Yeah, for kind of the same spec controllers, they're actually more expensive than the Elite controller, and they're not as good build quality for sure.
Yeah, that's what everyone's saying. Yeah. And like I said,
the fact that you can toggle, you have a toggle on the front of the Elite controller. You can toggle. And switch button layouts on the go, just on the fly. That's absolutely amazing.
It's better than that because you can actually have 250 games setups. So you could have one specifically for Halo. You go in Halo, you can have two modes for that game.
But I mean, just a quick toggle of your finger. You don't have to go to any menus or anything. You can have it set, you know, you can have two controller layouts set on that toggle and just switch between them. For whatever game you're playing.
And in the back of it, you could switch off to the triggers or to the, I guess we would call them whatever they're called, the flippers.
Yeah. What did you think of the plate D-pad?
That's my favorite part of it.
Do you think that's going to become... I was looking at that.
I love it. I will never use that D-pad. I will always use the disc.
Even in menus?
I like the way it feels, man. Yeah. That was my favorite thing about the control. Like I said, I'm not as hardcore as you guys probably are, especially or professional. I just like it as a controller. Put it this way, I am trying to figure out how I'm going to maybe return the controllers that I have now. I really just want to have like four of them, but you know the prices. I like it that much where I just want it to be the standard controller. That's how
much. Do you think they might be actually using this controller to test, maybe even like not a beta, but like put this out in the wild and see what people think of all the new features, and maybe in the future something like this could end up being cheap enough, not with all the features this has.
Well, I think this is
like the new D-pad that they were showing off. That could, if it's good enough, that could almost become standard.
It's good. I don't know if it'll become standard, but
I don't know, because the scuff's been out for a while, and then Evil controllers have been out for a while. These controllers have been here with these features, but they have been expensive. So I don't know. I would love to see it standard. I don't think everybody's going to use that, and I think it's for people specifically who know how to use it and know what it would be good for.
I mean, I wouldn't be opposed to them making the standard controller and just having the disc, just the disc for instead of the D-pad, because, like I said, I really love that. I don't know how to use it in a game, so maybe I won't like it, but I love the feel of it.
One thing that they said was that they were going to have third-party manufacturers work on the new accessories for it. I cannot wait to see what kind of goofy stuff that these people come up with, like a big joystick thing for one of the sticks or something, you know? Yeah.
Because it's customizable. Really, everything comes off.
Exactly. Flies. Yeah.
Well, what I was thinking is if they could make a cheaper version of it without all the steel, just make it plastic like the normal one. But magnets aren't expensive. They could just put magnets like it is on the Elite, but on the allow the interchangeable thumbsticks and allow the interchangeable D-pad, and that's it.
That too much work.
You don't really.
Just don't let Liam get close to it.
Really?
Don't let Liam get close to it.
I mean,
casual
people rip those things out.
Moms and dads are not going to want to put that stuff on.
Yeah, I guess so. But even
it's a good. I understand where you're going, but
Maybe if they could get it down to like $80 doing that.
If they get that thing down to $100, like, it's still a top 30 in Amazon bestsellers. I mean, it was.
Yeah, no.
It is crazy. If they get that thing down to 99, it's gonna. If they have that like as a deal, forget about it. You're talking sold out. It is that good. I'm very impressed with it.
Well, it's 150 up, so there's gonna be sales on it.
It's gonna get even more in demand when people actually get their hands on it. Like once the controller actually releases,
and
other people can try it. You know, you can like show your friends and stuff like that. And actually convince them.
Feel the weight of it. I mean, the weight might turn some off, but I think it's going to pretty much, most people are going to like it. It feels like a quality build. I mean.
Especially in America.
That was the two things that I noticed with the disc pad and the weight. Everything else is, it just feels nice. Really impressed with it.
So this is the new Duke.
Oh, the new Duke controller?
Nothing will replace the Duke.
It's not nearly as good as the Duke.
This is Duke Jr.
I agree. Like, the Duke is a thing of beauty and wonder. And
really?
PC gamers, too, will eat it up.
This is the Duke remastered.
The Duke controller was the closest thing to the Dreamcast controller at the time, and that's why all the Sega fans went right to Xbox, as they were like, the Duke feels right.
They shouldn't even have called this the Elite Controller. They should have just straight called it the Duke.
That would have been awesome, actually. Or
Duke Jr.
Such a great throwback.
Just some sort of variation of the Duke would be.
Duke 2.
Duke 2.
Or Duke 1.
Duke 1. Yes.
No. I think you're thinking too small. It could be like the Duke of Xbox. They could engage like
Zorbs.
A title.
For reminding me. Yeah, there are a bunch of people just bashing the controller because it was still using AA batteries. Oh. Man, if it didn't use AA batteries, I would have been really upset.
All the competitive players would have been pissed. So they know what they're doing.
Goodness.
All right, let's move on, guys.
Get some envelopes. You're golden.
I have them. Yeah, I love them.
Yeah, it lasts so long.
The best batteries. Yep. Let's talk about Xbox One backwards compatibility supports, Xbox 360 DLC achievements, and more. So if you're going to get it all. It's still up to the publisher to hit the approve button. But if they're going to approve the game, they're going to approve the DLC. So it's a win-win. It's awesome. I'm glad that backwards compatibility is going to be full featured.
It's not native.
Yeah, I know. Ooh. I need that PlayStation Now support, you know?
As far as I'm concerned, if the biggest complaint the media can give about this feature is that it's up to the publisher to approve it, that means the feature's awesome.
See,
what they've done is they've completely removed any barriers. Like, there's no reason for them to stop making stuff because it's so easy to do. They pretty much said all they need to do is just test it. Yep. You know, they'll have their internal stuff, and then they'll release it to the preview players, and then they'll say to people, hey, these are the games we're looking at, go and play them. Tell us what problems you've got. So, I mean, based on all the sort of montages they've got, I've seen the list here. I mean, it looks like all the major developers, publishers are in. You know, 2K, Ubisoft, I think, even like some EA.
EA seem to be the most into it because they said they're focusing on making new products, not remasters. So of course they want to do this.
And the thing about EA is that they've got EA Access, and I think that I know Vern is loving this idea that at Gamescom, Peter Moore is going to come out on stage again. You're going to go, oh yeah, you know, Dragon Age is coming into the vault as we announced at E3, and just so you know, and then he'll look at his watch or something and go, oh, and now all of like
the Dragon Ages are in the vault.
Yeah. These 10 360 games are now playable, and by the end of the year we'll have like another 20 or something. You know, that's the reason why I reckon the EA Access is going to be so big on Xbox now, is because it's going to have all their 360 games and all their Xbox One games.
Yes, all the Army of Two games.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
Well, one of them was back with Games with Gold. So
it was. It's happening.
Well, the thing everyone's like, but this disrupts remasters. I think what people don't understand is it costs publishers money to do remasters. Millions
of dollars. And they all came out already.
Millions of dollars. That means that instead of doing a remaster, they just sell the game that they already have. It's free. It doesn't cost them anything.
You know, one thing that this will do is that if a publisher is still going to do a remaster and they already have their game, you know, backwards compatible, on the one, they'll make it that much better. Because
exactly.
People are going to be able to see right there, okay.
People themselves, yes.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, they're going to have to actually work and make it something really special, which is really cool, and it's not going to be like a lame half-assed attempt at a remaster.
No, I see it's a third awesome. Possibility is where publishers hold off publishing it until the game comes
yes.
out, and then they say, hey, you're going to get Fallout 4 and
yeah.
your copy of Fallout 3 all at the same time, and then
that's
way when
genius.
You get it, you can go.
Or as a pre-order bonus 2 or 3 months before it comes out. That's
yeah.
the other possibility.
But
like
Gears
Fallout.
Of War Remaster, think about this. I know Gears of War 3 is coming out this month, but when Gears of War Remaster comes out, if they had the original Gears of War, like just the 360 version packed in with it, and then when people turn it on and somebody's playing the original and you're playing the remaster, it's mm-hmm. easy enough just to go, hey, this remaster is freaking awesome. You gotta come over. And it
yeah.
drives sales that way. And you might be able to attach it that way. I see a lot of publishers doing that. So you
people
would still
that
get a remaster,
have played
the but
old
you
game are
wait.
More likely to buy a remaster. I mean,
exactly.
that's simple
exactly.
enough.
Exactly.
It's really
and, I mean,
simple.
I cannot tell you how many people have asked me, you know, is it okay for me to jump into The Witcher 3 having not played the previous games? You know? And yeah, you're always going to lose something doing that. You're always going to lose something in the story doing that. But yeah, you're going to have fun because it's The Witcher 3, so... But yeah, it would definitely be beneficial for you to play the previous game.
Yeah,
because
you're
going to
end up, and honestly, what happens, because I never played the first two Witchers, and I played Witcher 3, you end up in a conversation where they're trying to figure out what you did in the previous games, and you have no idea what you're saying. It's just like,
yeah.
did you kill
yeah.
that guy? And you're like, hell yeah, I killed that guy, that's what I do. And then, literally, that was the conversation. It was really well done, but that's... You know, you had no idea what you were confirming or denying. You were just like, yeah, I killed
yeah.
him. And
well,
yeah.
The Witcher 2 was in one of the images advertising the backwards compatibility. So.
Yeah, yeah, they're going to get
a...
I
know
nice.
It's Games with Gold. So.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
And let's
that's
be honest,
huge.
GameSpot also is jumping up and down in joy. They are very happy
yeah.
right now that Microsoft
yes.
is not abandoning 360 games. It's
now,
like,
let me
what?
Ask... Can I ask you guys a question now?
Yeah.
Let's say Games for Gold, you download Gears 3, okay? You get it, put it in your library. From what I understand is once that game becomes backward compatible or it's on the list, it is going to automatically go into your queue. Is that true? Or
not into
or,
your, queue,
not your
queue, but you'll see
it's
it in your library.
Ready to, it's
so,
in
but
ready
I could,
to install.
Okay, so I could still – I could. So anybody who has Games for Gold should be downloading everything.
Yeah.
Yes.
Well,
yeah. Go to the website and buy it.
Yeah, in the podcast Unlocked that Phil Spencer was on, he said, you know, like 6 months ago, he was like, you know, I wanted to tell everyone, you got to download your 360 games, but I couldn't tell anyone. So I think that was
yeah.
kind of funny.
One thing that people might not be thinking about is that if you had owned the game on the disc, you know, in the past, you still get that on the one, right? So
yeah,
if you
we still have a big disc collection. So
yeah,
right. it's all
so
worth.
Like, I'll put it this way:
sell
I have all the
your
Gears
games,
games
on the disc and have it digitally. Can you not?
Yes.
No.
You
got to keep the disc.
You have to keep
yeah.
the disc in the
No.
Drive.
But here's the
yes.
thing: like
unless
Gears
it's
3,
a Games for Gold.
Yeah, if it's Games for Gold, you got
unless
it.
Unless it's
your
a
gold
fine.
Okay.
Yeah,
because it's
yeah.
a digital copy.
So like, if you own the Gears of War 3 game right now, but it just came out with Games of Gold, you can go. And with 360 Games with Gold, you keep those games forever. On Xbox One, you don't, but on 360, if you end your subscription today, you still keep all the 360 games you redeemed.
Right.
So, no, the second, like this month, if you have gold right now, you go ahead and redeem it, you can get rid of your disc. Don't even worry about it.
Now, do you guys see them doing a marketplace for 360 on
oh,
Xbox
yes.
One?
No.
No.
Because that could open up a can of worms. You know, people might
it's
get pissed.
It's not...
No.
Going to be a 360 marketplace. It's going to be the Windows 10 universal store and every single Windows 10 device.
But I think they'll sell 360 games on the Xbox.
Yeah, well,
yeah.
that's what
yeah.
I wanted. I want to buy, you know, and they're running into a problem with multi-discs, as you guys heard.
It's not going to be that way at launch, though. They did say there won't be 360 games on the store at launch. They haven't confirmed whether or not it'll come later on, though.
No. I mean,
but there's
yeah.
no
they
way they don't
have
a section for it.
All of the backwards compatible games already have store pages. I've yes. got the Toy Soldiers one up. So, you know, it's not a 360 store pages, and literally an Xbox One store page, and it's got all the broadcasts, all the images, all the Game Hub stuff, like everything is there. So,
mm-hmm.
you know, all they need to do is just add a button that says buy. So they'll, right. you know, they'll get to it soon.
Well, because, I mean, like a game like Blue Dragon and Lost Odyssey, you might, they said that it's possible that you might not be able to get it because it's those are multi-discs.
No, they're working on it now.
Yeah, that's just them figuring out how to do it, and they're good to go.
Right,
they could convert into a digital format, just make a digital version of
they'll
it.
They'll have that's, to make it a games-on-demand version in order for right. it to happen, essentially.
Exactly. Yeah. And if they can't make it happen, they could. There's a possibility of making it digital, correct? Let's just say they couldn't figure out the multi-disc.
There's only one multi-disc game, I think, that's digital right now on the 360 store. It's GTA 5. Right. So
Mass Effect 3 as well. Mass Effect 2 and 3 multi-disc.
2 and 3 aren't on the store for 360. They aren't? Games on demand, no.
No.
You sure?
This is just, it just opens up a completely new venue. I mean, I really was taken back by the reaction by everyone in social media, and you know, everyone just went crazy. I really didn't think that would have that type of effect, but obviously it does. And you know, it hasn't really gotten out, like in the holidays when they, I guess they'll do commercials or they'll advertise it. I really see that as a big selling point for Xbox, especially with parents and stuff like that, because that's the first question I get asked from the guys at work, does it play 360 games? And when I say no, they get pissed. So
they're not gonna be pissed anymore. At the end of the day, what I tell everybody is you had 80 million Xbox customers last generation. And then on top of that, it was an 8-year long generation. It was probably one of the longest generations in video game history when it came to a single console. So you got both PS3 and Xbox 360 that lasted forever in this huge catalog of games. It makes sense to have backwards compatibility. Like, but PlayStation Now made sense because of how complex the cell processor is to actually try to replicate on an x86 processor. At the end of the day, yes, it's going to be a lot nicer how Microsoft's doing it, but it's a must-have feature because of the last generation being so tough. But I think it was well worth it. Worth the effort, and I think it'll reward them in the American market.
Yeah,
I just think it's great that this is the first thing Phil Spencer did when he became head of Xbox. He said, "Okay, backwards compatibility," and that's great. That's great. Mm. That means he's thinking the right way.
And they didn't even know if it was going to work. Like they said, it wasn't until like you said that, you know, they worked on it for sort of 8 months or so, and it didn't. And it wasn't until January that they actually got it up on Xbox One, and were like, "Oh, this does actually work."
Well, we should have been tipped. I'm sorry, Tim.
No, this is kind of interesting on this because Phil said that he was that they started this a year ago, but I talked to three people, one being the head engineer of backward compatibility because I went to. After E3, I went to the broadcast booth, and I met, and I actually, Albert Pinello, I was talking to him, and we were talking about the backwards compatibility, and the engineer, here's the big guy, the big talk, he's the head engineer of backward compatibility, and it was some gentleman, he didn't know who I was, it was just an engineer, and you know, to me, it sounds, I could almost remember them saying that they were trying to do this since launch. And that they actually came to a point where they couldn't do it, and they thought it was they were about to scrap it. So I don't know. I got conflicting stories on that. Phil said a year ago, but
it was more than a year ago though, because if it was when he first was
maybe it was just assigned that he knew to
head of Xbox,
it
would have been when was he head of Xbox? It was in January or something.
March.
March.
Oh, March. Okay. Okay.
So. So the thing is that they could have looked at, because things we know that they were looking at streaming solutions, like there's the, you know, they've had multiple streaming solutions where, you know, they've worked on them, and at some point they've said, you know, this isn't working. So it could have been the backwards compatibility then was something very different to what it is now. It, you know, and this, you know, it could have been that, you know, they looked at different options, and a year ago Phil said, look, we need to pick this option and we need to just try and make that work. Because,
okay,
you know, I don't think they would have, you know, they would have talked about it for a long time before doing it, because that's usually how these things go. So,
on stage, he said that they didn't know if this was going to work, but recently, you know, they were able to do it
in January this year. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, what they did, it's...
You made it pretty clear that it was very iffy.
It's no small achievement what they did. I mean, this is not... Like, I know a lot of people are like, oh, they did it. You know, it's all it is software emulation. You know how hard that shit is? You know how many people that have been trying to emulate 360 on PC? They're all pissed off right about now because Microsoft managed to do it on an Xbox One. It's not easy by any means. And the fact that they're doing it, too, is pretty nuts. Yeah.
I mean, the fact that it's basically a 360.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. It's a digital 360.
Yeah, like Phil said. Phil said like the Xbox One is literally playing Xbox 360 the game. And that's how it's free.
Now, do we think this will come to PC at some point?
No.
No way.
I don't. No, I think the code is so specific to actually make it work on that processor that you would have to recode everything to really work.
That's
for
true.
Every
it would be tough across multiple different computers.
Because
yeah.
let's say the next generation console after this, even though the 360's backwards compatibility works on the Xbox One, you would still have to reprogram that emulator to work on the next round of processors. Like,
right.
It's just too tough. Well, I mean,
on
maybe.
On PC, you'd have so many people pirating, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
I mean, just so many people figuring out ways to bypass the security checks and everything.
Yeah, that too.
But, Fern, you can play on PC by streaming your Xbox directly to your Windows 10 PC.
I think what they might try to do is, on their store, say, for example, Super Meat Boy gets released on the Windows 10 store, they will perhaps try and get developers to make that version cross-buy. So like when Sony released a new game and then it just fits into their cross-buy thing, I think Microsoft will try and do the same thing. So if you have a game that's on Xbox One, 360 and PC, they'll try and say they'll try and get as many developers as they can to fit them all together so that it is just free across all of them. Like that might be what they do rather than, so they would go for cross-buy rather than emulating on PC. Because I mean, things that the whole reason they did it was because they wanted 360 owners to upgrade to an Xbox One. They didn't, and Phil said that to IGN. You know, they didn't do it to get so that all the PC people that dumped their Xboxes could then play their 360 stuff and can then continue giving Valve money. So,
right,
you know,
well,
you know, it's really disheartening that the PC community has gotten to a point where they don't even want competition anymore. It's Steam or nothing else. And if it's anything but Steam, then it's shitty, which is
GOG.
It's really sad.
GOG's made some ground.
They have taken some ground, but it's still that attitude. Like even you talk about what Microsoft's doing with Xbox on Windows 10, and people are like, "Oh, it's locked to their ecosystem, though, isn't it?" Well, then I'm not going to use it.
Yeah, you will if you want to play it.
Well, it's like people—they're like, "I don't want a console-like experience." Isn't Steam a console-like experience?
It's exactly what they want. It's a platform, you know?
And I got news for you.
Platforms bring fanboys. So that's
it's a dangerous place for Microsoft to be with PC gamers just wanting Steam.
Well, I can tell you one thing. Not to interrupt, but...
No, good, Tim.
Oh, you're fine.
Oh.
My people that I've talked to, and, you know, I talk to a lot of people... I think that Xbox and PC is definitely going to merge that way, meaning they're going to be all in one ecosystem, basically.
Well, we're seeing that already, yeah.
Well, I mean, I'm thinking they're going to do it fully. They're going that way.
Do you really think it's going to be every game, though, or do you think they're going to...
I was asked about it. I'm going to be honest. And I told people about this that the community will be upset.
Is this next year or the next 10 years?
Are you sure they just weren't talking about like what's happening with Gears Remastered and the
and
Killer
and
Instinct?
Sea of Thieves.
Things like that to me make sense. If a game looks like it could possibly be free to play or a shared world experience, you know, you want to get as many people playing that game as you can. That way you have a big
I was asked by some pretty high people, what do you think of PC Xbox games going to PC? And reading between the lines, I'm going to tell you right now what I think is going to happen. I think it's all going that way, meaning one ecosystem, Gears 4 possibly on PC. I never said that. I always said
Halo,
they wouldn't
though.
Do that. I think it's just going to merge into that.
Yeah,
that
I think
goes,
I've heard a lot that the next platform is going to be just PC. It's like they're not going to come out with another Xbox, where it's just going to be all.
Well, I think
PC. They would.
They'll never abandon the Xbox box.
What I mean by that is that they might have something like a Steam machine. Yeah. You know, where with Steam, you know, they have exclusives for the Steam machine, but it's still PC.
I'm really the feelers that I got, and from pretty big people, console industry is even Sony. To get another console, I don't think anything. I don't think that Sony's planning on it. I don't think that Xbox is planning on it. That's just where we are right now. Would that change? I don't know, but I can tell you that the impression that I got, and I asked a couple of questions, and I was talking to, like I said, pretty high people.
Yeah, but Tim, people are going to want a box that they don't have to worry about building or upgrading.
I'm just saying that the R&D and the money that they have to put into another console, that neither Sony or Microsoft is ready to make that step right now.
I think what they see, what the investors are seeing, is that you have all these people on console, but then you have all of this potential on PC. You know,
I think everybody's missing the point is there's other technologies that are in play that both Microsoft and Sony are pushing towards, and that's cloud-based technology.
Yeah.
And the next, let's say this generation, last 8 years, we might be in time just to say, hey, keep your Xbox One under the TV. No, it's not 4K, but it can do 4K video, and we'll just pump the file from the cloud straight to your TV, and it'll be good to go. And you won't
and I
need
don't
to buy
think that they're going to drop the Xbox brand. I think that
well,
they will
not, yeah.
obviously
I think Xbox
they
will
won't
PC.
Ever drop the Xbox brand. I think it'll just become something a little different than what it is now, and more like what Valve is doing with the Steam machines.
Well, I think the bottom line with this is I don't think Sony has an avenue to get to the PC without getting in with someone else. They lost SOE. They sold off SOE. Right now they're a console only company. They release titles to PC, but they don't have their foot in the door. Microsoft's different. They have an entire operating system. They're literally bringing Xbox to Windows. All that stuff you're going to have cross-buy, cross-platform. You don't get that with Sony. Sony, like I said, they even got rid of their SOE stuff, which was their big connection to PC. It's gone. So I don't really see an avenue for Sony to get rid of the console.
Well,
unless
Sony's
they get in big.
They're also investing in On Live and they bought On Live and Kotaku. It's I don't think we're going to get another console from what the people I talk to. I hate to say that because I want another console, but I don't really like the feelers that I got.
I think we'll get a console version of whatever's coming next, not necessarily its own close
I just
platform.
Think that Xbox and PC are going to basically merge, especially with Windows 12. When these Windows 12 titles, it's just going to be
10?
On
10 DirectX 12.
Yeah, DirectX 12.
Or no,
yeah.
By the time the next version comes out, maybe it will.
Yeah, that's right. It might be a 12.
What did I say DirectX?
You said Windows 12, but
you could be right.
Here's the thing. Windows comes out every 3 years, so time frame wise, you might be completely correct, Tim. It could be Windows 12.
No, I do think that that's where they're going. And you're going to see, I think Gears 4 might be a title that you see on PC. Put it that way. Yeah. That's my they asked me, I said that the fans would be upset. The core fans would be upset because they want to feel special. But I don't really think that they wanted to hear that answer. I think that they wanted to hear, we don't care. But
I agree on Gears 4 because they're planting the seed with Gears Ultimate Edition right now. So
Gears Ultimate Edition was already a PC game.
I know.
So but the thing is, I'm 100% convinced it's going to be another console, both Sony and Microsoft, because Microsoft are not going to stick around with the Xbox One for 8 years, and neither is Sony. Because
what if it's cloud-based at that point?
But the
technology won't be there yet.
They'll both do one more console. But the thing is that Sony have set out their stall very clearly, right? They bought Gaikai, they bought the online stuff. Sony want to go towards streaming. Okay, and Microsoft have set out their stall pretty clear, is that they want to go towards PC, because Sony don't like PC because it's not their.
Not theirs.
Yeah, exactly. Whereas Windows is Microsoft's. And yes, Xbox and PC are going to continue to come together until they're one. And the next Xbox console, it'll still be a games console like the Xbox One is, but they'll have this. They'll have a brand new box. They'll have a system. It'll be TV friendly. Yeah, you know, it'll
PC which, friendly too.
But
it'll be the same that, games that run on it that run on PC.
Yeah. But isn't that what an Xbox One is? Like, it's that is, you know, because the architecture with the PS4 and Xbox One is so similar to PC, they're already there. They just need to go that one step further and make all their releases.
It's
like
basically a hyper optimized PC version of a game, more or less.
Yeah. The thing is that the reason why consoles aren't going anywhere is because Microsoft don't own GTA, they don't own Assassin's Creed, they don't own COD, but Microsoft get a huge slice of that market for IPs that they don't own. Okay, if everybody goes towards PC, this is part of the reason why Microsoft is so interested in PC now, is because Valve is making all this money and Microsoft, and on their platform, and Microsoft aren't getting a single piece of the pie because they boost it up. So now they're trying to, like, the console market is huge. They can't not make another one. That would be so short-sighted, it would be unbelievable. I mean, you can see how well the PS4 is doing and the Xbox One is still doing well. Like, they will not miss out on that market. It's too big.
Do you think it'll be a closed console, like what we have, or do you think it'll be more like what a Steam machine is?
The next Xbox will still be a closed console.
Yeah.
But it'll be more like what Xbox is going to be with mod capability and all that sort of stuff.
I don't think you'll be able to hook a mouse up to it and run Windows on this.
Exactly.
It'll be exactly as it is now, but all the games will also be on PC on their market. And that's the thing is that at the end of the day, you know, I can't say I'm too bothered about PC, but I just want to play great games. So if they feel that the way that
it's going that way,
but the thing is, it is the future. Like, it's an inevitability. You can kick and scream and fight it all you want, but eventually, Microsoft, you know, this console market is going to
convert. Right, and they're pushing for that. This
will help them get exclusives as well. You got to remember that because
I had brought that up to these people. I said, you know, why do you have to do it that way? Why can't you, you know, bring some of the PC RTSs to Xbox One? I says, you know, I mean, it doesn't have to be a one.
If you're gonna make a console RTS, make a console focused RTS. Don't bring this crap to the Xbox.
But the fact is there's games on PC that we would want to play on Xbox. How are they going to implement it? That's up to them. You know, that's what I said, and they agreed. They said that's something that they could look into. But, you know, I do think from what I gather that this is where it's going. I mean, there's no doubt. I was somebody who said, you know, this would never happen. So now
I think all you need to look at is go watch Microsoft's last build conference and look at what they came out with. With native Android, native iOS with Windows 10, they're going towards a platform where everything will run on everything.
Right.
And that's what ultimately they want. If that platform takes 20 years to happen, it's going to take 20 years to happen. But I think the added complication into all of this is the sales. And the problem is that even if you go look back and look at Titanfall, which is a game we actually have the sales numbers for, only 10% of those sales were on PC. Compared to Xbox One. So I think it's more about moving Xbox One players to PC rather than moving PC players to Xbox One. There are a lot of people that just want to play in front of a TV, and that's ultimately their challenge.
I think it's time to move on.
This is a pretty big subject.
Yeah, with what you said, a lot of people just want to play in front of a TV. That's what Steam machines are doing. Steam machines are bringing PC to the TV and making it easier.
They also want to
keep it in the family. Like we said, that, you know, if this thing is 10 years away, they have to start making it now, because if they just turn up in 10 years time, they're going to kill their own division and kill all their plans. So they've got to do it now. But like their plan will be, you know, you'll have the hardcore gamer who wants to play this game and they can play it on his PC, and then their little brother or their son or whatever, they just want to play in front of the TV. They don't care about, you know, all the PC stuff. So, you know, keep it in the family, and that's how you can get your PC and your Xbox sold.
And also together. something like this where This is stuff that I'm not. I didn't make this stuff up. This is stuff that I heard. Like you buy
fire.
You buy Xbox Gears, okay? Well, you could play it free on your PC as well.
Because, well, yeah, they talked about cross-buy already. So
right.
Yeah. Well, not only that, you get three licenses. You get one for your PC, and you get one for your home console, and one for your account.
That's where it's going. Right. I mean, there's no other way to put it.
My issue with that is we are moving on. We
detract from the Xbox brand.
Well, yeah. I said that, Mike. I told him that. So
I don't think they'll drop the brand.
I gave my opinion on that, and I was along with you, Mike. But they shot back. Well, what if you could play Gears on PC for free? That's what basically they said.
So that was an interesting conversation, but we got more things to talk about other than this.
Can we talk about ReCore?
No. Yeah. We're gonna talk about ReCore, but let's talk about Don't Starve first. The giant edition coming to the Xbox One.
What?
That's nice. Let's go.
No, that's it. No love.
It's a game, Tim. It's like a survival game. It's made by the people that did Mark of the Ninja on Xbox 360, and they've just made
pretty good
Invisible Ink. I played it very briefly, but I mean, it's good to see them back on Xbox because, as I said, they did do Mark of the Ninja, and then everything else has been very pro Sony. So it's
PC, they've been PC developer because they had like Don't Starve was a very strong PC game for a long time, right? Because it had a heavy modding scene, and Don't Starve Together was an early access thing, all that sort of stuff, which is a cooperative survival. But Don't Starve as a whole is an incredibly good game that I've had my eye on for a while because it's go look it up on YouTube and check out what about it makes it stand out. Because first it's the art style, without a question. The art style is, it will capture your eyes. And then it's also a survival game, but it's not like a shitty survival game. It's a very logical survival game. It's like, you're cold, build a fire, or put some warm clothes on. It's dark, stand around a fire. You're going insane. That's different. Right? There's some very eldritch, stuff about it. So kinda check dark. It out. Yeah. It's very dark. It's very
dark. Yeah, and it's... almost dark in a cute way, the way the art style is. It's very popular for younger gamers. I know a lot of younger gamers that are just always playing Don't Starve on their pads and their phones or something. Yeah. It's an awesome
game.
It's
like if Tim Burton made a video game.
Exactly. Except it doesn't have Johnny Depp.
All right. Well, moving on.
The main character kind of looks like Johnny Depp in a way.
Don't Starve the movie starring Johnny Depp's coming out next year. So.
All right. Moving on. Xbox Live Games with Gold for July features Assassin's Creed, Gears of War 3, Plants vs. Zombies, and So Many Me. Is that what it is?
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Many Me and Assassin's Creed Black Flag are the Xbox One games. And the 360 ones are Plants vs. Zombies and Gears of War 3. And they also announced that we will get two new Xbox One games each month from now on.
Nice.
One was Massive Chalice, and they haven't revealed the other one yet as well.
No. The two new Xbox One games this month are Assassin's Creed Black Flag. Well, next month are Assassin's Creed Black Flag and... So Many Me.
The banner they showed also had Massive Chalice, another question mark game on it.
That's because Massive Chalice was last month, so that's why it's to the left side. And to the right side is a question mark showing, well, what's going to be next month?
I didn't think that's how it worked.
That's how they do the pictures.
Yeah.
It is.
I guess I never noticed that.
It's all right.
I used to think it was a surprise that they were going to actually name another one.
It's confusing.
It's actually Pool Nation.
That's why someone edited that picture.
People
and put
actually
Pool Nation
pissed that
and,
Pool Nation was off. I was reading the comment.
No, it was a joke.
I know, but there was some people that were actually pissed. I couldn't believe it.
Someone photoshopped in the Pool Nation image to the question mark in one image. It was pretty funny.
Tim, did you get to ask Phil Spencer what's up with Pool Nation?
No.
Okay. You shouldn't have.
I did read the Larry's comments, and there was some. There was actually one guy who was pissed that there was no, and he was serious.
But
wow,
yeah, I'm really excited about this though because this finally makes them compete with PS Plus. PS Plus, we're seeing like four new games almost every month. But now, with backwards compatibility, if they can get these things day and date with the releases, you could have 4 games you can play on your Xbox One every month. So hopefully they can get it to that, because that'd be very competitive.
Yeah.
I wonder how long the rollout is really going to be. I mean, I think Mike has a lot of pressure on him. Yubara, you know, I mean, obviously this is kicked off, so people really want the games now. Like, they, you know, in the preview, they want these new games. So I don't know how the turnaround is, but he said 100 by holiday and then 100 more, right?
He said 100 by launch and then hundreds the month following.
All I care about is Beautiful Katamari. As long as I have that game.
It's going to be a while, probably. Unless it's super easy and they can get it up, you know? But do we know if he's creative director on any of the projects now, or do you think he shifted entirely to this for now? Because that would make sense, because wasn't he the one people were thinking was on...
He's the head of the engineering for the software team.
Yeah,
He controls everything.
Okay, so he moved off as the creative director positions.
Yeah, he's the hot shot right now at Microsoft.
Yeah.
But he has a lot of pressure on him, and he's, you know, we actually went to dinner with him, and he was talking about how, you know, marketing, you know, there's a lot of pressure on it. You know, he was just basically saying how, what was he saying about the PNG, how they wanted it out, the snapshot, and he said no, he gave them resistance.
They wanted to do it right, yeah.
Yeah, he says we're doing it right. And, you know, marketing was like, well, let's just get it out. He said, no, we're doing it right. And that's the way he is. He's very – he's not going to cave to marketing. I think that's pretty much clear what I got from the conversation is that he's going to do it right, and he doesn't care.
That's what got them in trouble with the original launch, not, you know, caving into that stuff. Right. So, yeah, that's a good
because they wanted it out, but he said, I do things right. I want the PNG. And then obviously, as he waited and they got the PNG for the screenshots, people loved it. So,
yeah.
I don't think their marketing department's used to the gaming community. I think, Microsoft's marketing covers the entire company with the way it's
right. They're two different companies. I heard that and. You know, you wouldn't think that Yubara and Aaron actually, they're not on the same, like, they're different, totally different, you know, entities, put it that way. Like, Mike does his engineering thing, and he says, I won't even tell anybody. He says, that's what I do. Like, he doesn't like the pressure, obviously, of get this out, get that out. He's going to do it, and he's going to do it right. Yeah. But now they're probably all over him for the backward compatibility.
Because there's one thing I want to know about this guy, though. How does he make the time to play all those games and work on his gamer score like that?
Mm. Isn't he put like hundreds of hours into Diablo 3 on PC or something?
It's insane how much he plays as Xbox.
Gamer score is like 160,000 as well.
I don't think he sleeps.
Yeah, no, he's a really...
You got to test stuff, and testing means doing a full playthrough.
You remember what Kudo Sonoda said at E3? You know, when I'm at work and I want to play my games on my... Oh, wait.
yeah, that was good. He slipped up next to Phil Spencer. That was wonderful. Giant Bomb E3 coverage. Yeah. He slipped up and made it sound like he plays video games at work all the time. So that's what's great about the guys who are working at Microsoft now, though, especially at Xbox Division. It seems like there's a real gamer first attitude.
It seems like they actually do play them.
Yeah.
Which you don't, which is ironic from Don Matrick's background, but
yeah.
Like he never gave out his gamer tag or talked about playing them or anything. You know, it was just all about the business stuff. And that seems to be where their sort of downfall was, that they forgot to actually just play the games.
Yeah, know about them. No, but Mike's in charge of. I think he put a picture up. He's in charge of. He was in charge of all the engineering as far as that for the software team. So, like the guy that I talked to that was in charge of the backward compatibility, he's actually
working under him. Yeah.
Yeah, he's actually in that picture. If you look, they were all out to dinner, and he's in that picture. But yeah, no, Mike's really, he's going places. He's really made a big impression. He's like the hot commodity right now. So, you know,
Well, maybe you could float my idea by him for backwards compatibility, to put codes on drink lids, you know, so that we can go out and then get, you know, just buy a drink for whatever game we want.
Say this again. That just blew my mind.
You know, a QR code. Yeah.
The thing is, though, I could actually see stuff like, oh, you have this game, right? You have the disc of it. You can prove it. Okay, we can generate a digital copy of it, right? If they could do that for multi-disc games, that would be pretty incredible.
Yeah. Right? Or if they could just make it
work around.
Right, or just make it available. Make it a Games for Gold. I mean, I know that Phil wants Blue Dragon and Lost Odyssey. Those two games he wants, but they're both multi-disc, so...
Oh, that's going to happen. They need to release them both the same month for Games with Gold, too.
That's my workaround. I mean, you can't charge for them because people will go crazy. There is such a pressure right now going on with this that, you know... They've seen the numbers. It's like when I talked to that guy with Pinello, the engineer, they said all the numbers spiked. Like the preview members went up 24% preview applications. So they're internally, they're seeing these numbers. They're seeing people. I mean, I see my feed every day. Everyone's talking about backward compatibility, and we are 10 days off of E3. They're asking when you're going to add these games. 50 over a million votes for backward compatibility on the Xbox feedback site. That site has never been that popular. It has jumped tenfold. It's crazy.
So many people called me and asked me to add them.
To the
preview program.
On the Xbox One subreddit, there was actually after the announcement, there was one of the devs. He didn't identify who exactly he was, but it was one of the devs working on backwards compatibility, and he actually said that he's trying to convince people. He's trying to convince the people that are higher up in it to allow the preview members to have more access to more of the games, because apparently right now they're curating it really to a really high standard. So these games run very well, even for the preview members. But he was talking about how it would be great. You know, everyone, and I think everyone feels the same way. Just let the preview members play these games and allow us to help you out. So we can get these out so much faster.
You have Digital Foundry running.
I know.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah.
So it puts it in them in a tough position.
And they're like, look, they fucked it up. It's like, it's a beta, dude. Yeah.
The only way to solve that is to have everybody sign an NDA. You know, and then your gamer won't be able to do that. But then the preview members won't be able to talk about it, anything. Yeah.
Are we in a Toby Keith music video?
But I mean, I didn't really have too much of a problem with that Eurogamer thing, you know, because, you know, they were just testing it and seeing what it's like. You know, they know it's a beta.
True.
I mean, they did, you know, it wasn't like they skimmed over the games that played well. I mean, it, from their tests, it was a fact that Mass Effect wasn't running, but we already knew that it had problems, and I'm sure that they'll revisit it once Microsoft get down. I mean, at the end of the day, Microsoft can also use this, you know, if they have if Digital Foundry have got data about how these games are running, they can look at it and say, okay, you know, we can see that and we can work on it. You know, if the frame rate
working for Microsoft, then
pardon?
So your gamer is working for Microsoft and helping them test the games?
Well, I mean, that's how thing. I mean, was it Diablo 3 had on PS4 had the bad frame pacing issue that Blizzard weren't aware of until Digital Foundry looked at it and were like,
they fixed it before launch.
Yeah. So, you know, these things can help them just like our feedback.
Yeah, I do think it's a little early, though.
I don't think there's anything you can really do, though, because they can't really mess with the code. And if it's VSync causing it,
right,
there ain't really nothing they can do to change it. Like, there was actually a YouTube video.
Yeah,
and it's funny. It's funny. Not if it's in the code.
If
it's locked in the code, you can't just turn off the VSync.
You can't.
The game doesn't have VSync on 360, though.
Yeah. Exactly.
That's no, yeah, it does. It's because someone actually made a YouTube video showing why it looks like the way it does. The reason it looks the way it does is because on the 360 version, it does screen tearing. The Xbox One version doesn't have screen tearing.
Right, so they would have to turn off the VSync on the Xbox One app or whatever.
The emulator.
The, on the 360 app.
Is the game
app,
playable?
Yeah.
Is the game really playable? I mean, is
it's the same frame rate, it's just without tearing.
All right. Everybody, let's take a step back. Let's calm down. All right. We got to find a better solution so people can realize who's talking. Especially with all these people not on camera. I'm looking at
I'm
you,
on
Steve,
camera.
Jason, Tim.
I need to buy a better camera.
All right.
Can we talk about ReCore?
Well, before we talk about ReCore, I just want to say what's up to Chloe, aka 6RRR3. She tuned into the Twisted Tuesday and came to watch the show. So thank you so much. You're awesome. What else? We had another question. We had talk about the Amazon UK pre-order percentage hike. So Forza,
that's kind of goofy.
It's whatever. We'll talk about it for a second. After E3, Forza went up by, what was it, 1,000% in sales from where it was? That's pretty cool. It doesn't mean really anything other than people saw that trailer and went, oh, fuck, that looks really cool. And, you know, hey, it's awesome. I'm glad Forza.
I mean, the only meaningful thing you can get out of it is that other games that were announced earlier also with Forza didn't have as much of a hike, and that's about as much as you can get out of it. Right. Like Uncharted didn't get as big of a crease in pre-orders as Forza did. That's about as much as you can get out of it.
That's true, but like that's why percentages are bullshit though. Because let's say Uncharted is like had 1 million pre-orders already, and E3 hits and they get, you know, let's say 20 more pre-orders, whatever, just randomly. But Forza's at 5 pre-orders, but it gets 1 million more.
Look, I know so where you're getting at, but...
No, but it's a percentage thing, and percentages are just... I know, it's stupid. But like, statistics are stupid.
You do got to remember that the Forza community... the Forza community is the kind of community that the second they announce Forza, they go out and pre-order this game.
That's true. I'm just saying. Like,
so it's not like 5
statistics
pre-orders.
Are dumb. Okay.
Well, I know they're dumb.
You can have statistics say whatever the fuck you want at the end of the day.
Look, I'm just
it's
excited
how
that's
look, we have a political election coming up. That's how polls work. It's all BS. Don't trust it. The articles are dumb. Just move on. That's all I'm gonna say. That's all that needs to be said. It's dumb.
I've got the list up here. I mean, what I mean on the list for the top 10 games. Do you want me to list them, or the top 10 games that were pre-ordered, not the percentages?
Okay.
Do you want me to list them?
Go for it.
So the most pre-ordered game over E3 was Rare Replay. Then Gears of War Ultimate Edition, Doom, Dishonored 2, Final Fantasy VII Remake, Gears of War 4. South Park for Fractured But Whole, Horizon.
Wait a
Zero
second,
Dawn.
We gotta enjoy that title for
it's
a minute.
It's so good in your accent, too. The Fractured But Whole.
I don't sound like that.
Terrible.
Number 8, Horizon Zero Dawn. Number 9, Dishonored Definitive Edition. And number 10, the Xbox One Elite Wireless Controller.
Wow. Yeah.
I mean...
But these were all things that were announced at E3, right?
Yeah.
Not announced before.
Yeah.
Like right.
I mean,
before.
three of those are out in August. I mean, the thing is, the reason why Rare Replay is so high, outside of the fact that we love Rare, is that it's out the 5th, it's out the 4th of August.
Right, soon.
So, you know, I mean, it's always going to be...
a birthday present for me, basically.
It's always going to be skewed in some way, but you know, I mean, if anything, it just shows the popularity of the Xbox brand. I mean, four of that top 10 only on Xbox, so you know, that's pretty good.
Did you count Shenmue in that list?
I have to ask something.
Yes.
Dustin, how are you?
I'm doing great, but I was going to ask you, like, once we got past, like, all this news, but, yeah. How are you doing, Vern, now that we can stop, slow it down?
I turned it into how are you?
I wanted to...
So you got to answer.
I'm going to turn out the lights, Detroit. Well, Vern, I'm doing pretty good.
I'm doing good, too, man. I'm doing good.
Are you sure?
Feeling good. Yeah, it makes me feel really warm inside when you ask me how I'm doing, you know?
Well, just remember, you can share your relationship letters with Vern at letters@xboxuncut.com.
For listeners, you have to see the lighting in Dustin's video here. It's some mood lighting.
I turned out the lights, man. I had to. You got to do it. You got to do it. Oh, my God. Vern, you got me. You got me. I will say it. But is there any other news that we skipped that happened this
week?
ReCore!
I keep on saying I want to talk about ReCore.
Phil Son.
All right. Vern, tell me about
the 2D platformer.
There's a few things. There's a few things. There's a few things. Michael. Phil Spencer did see it. He said there's a gameplay demo that he played, so that's good news first. But Kotaku did an article on this, and they seem to pick up a lot more details than all the other E3 interviews that went on at the same time. And the things they actually were able to get Inafune and the guys at Armature to say was that, first off, it's third-person action-adventure, which we know. It's non-linear, which we didn't know for sure, which is good news. They also confirmed that it's a three-way partnership. So it's Concept, which is the studio that Inafune-san is in charge of, is leading the high-level development, the creative decisions. Armature, which is the ex-retro developers who worked on Metroid Prime, are in charge of the gameplay and the systems. And then Microsoft Studios is actually has a hand in development as well, and they're mostly focused on the story elements of the game. They also implied that there's Metroidvania-like elements, so meaning different sections of the game open up as you get more powers, but the powers you get are essentially going to be the different cores. And as you get the different cores and put them in the different robots, they function as keys to open up new areas of the world. So it sounds a lot like Metroid. Also, new areas will open up as sandstorms come through and change the layout. So it's a few new details. So it does kind of sound like Metroid Prime in a lot of ways, as well as, there's a female protagonist, So, this sounds pretty cool to me.
I've been saying it for a while. If Nintendo doesn't make a new proper Metroid game, somebody else is. And somebody else is. Somebody else is making a proper Metroid game. And same thing with F-Zero, right? I think that, arguably Microsoft probably could have gotten some people into, if they made a Halo space game or they had rebooted Crimson Skies, they probably would have gotten people who were looking for Star Fox, but...
I think you got some magic here, Michael.
What's up?
Because it's been hinted at a third Forza game.
Yes.
No.
Forza
not
Zero?
Happening. Phil Spencer said this week.
No. He said there's always a possibility.
Well, no. You he can't
said,
trust...
He said not right now.
He you flat out
trust,
denied it.
Hold on, guys. You also can't trust... When Phil Spencer says no, it doesn't really mean no either. He also said there wasn't going to be a Summer of Arcade.
He didn't say there wouldn't be. He said there would be.
No, but this interview was done during E3 when they hadn't announced Summer Spotlight.
Yeah.
And he did talk about what was then announced 2 days later, which was that it would be a place to showcase all digital titles, not just indies or sort of arcade games, which is what they're doing.
Yeah.
So he didn't say no. I think he couldn't turn around and say, oh, well, if you watch the Xbox Daily Show later, we're actually going to announce this thing called Summer Spotlight.
Yeah, and he said he likes what they're doing with Playground right now with Forza Horizon. So it really does sound like Forza Horizon 3 will be their next game.
The thing is, I don't think they would make an F-Zero Forza game. If anything, they're going to make a even more arcadey or a combat Forza.
No, but just think about it. They could have the logo. It would say Forza, but they could have it sideways and it would say F-Zero on it.
The thing is, I've said it before, I'll say it again. If they were to make... Okay, have you seen the movie Death Race?
Yes.
The Jason Statham Death Race? Make that into a video game, right? Have you be a prisoner, make your character, be in prison, recruit a team, build a car, race it, and destroy each other. I could see that being incredibly successful if done properly, and considering what Forza's engine can do, I can see that... I can see the pieces falling into place in my head. Very easily.
Maybe something happens with Forza. I think it's not going to be this next year after Forza 6. I think it does sound like he's saying Horizon 3 will be next after Motorsport. But yeah, maybe something after that, things will change. You know.
Honestly, if they're doing anything, it's probably going to be Forza Rally Sport.
Yeah,
I would think so too.
But not to damper expectations.
Demolition Derby, tractor pull.
I mean, the thing is, IGN podcast, if you listen to the IGN podcast, like it wasn't one of those things where he was sort of hinting. Like, it seemed like the sort of thing that he genuinely had not really considered. And he just sort of, you know, and he said not right now. And he did say, you know, they might have plans to look at something else in the future. But he just said, you know, at the end of the day, we have Turn 10, we have Playground. He said Playground are top notch, you know, but that just right now, you know, everyone's kind of busy. So, I, the way he said it seemed like a very sort of sincere, I hadn't actually really thought of doing it.
He seemed really happy with Playground, too. I wonder if that will be an acquisition over the next year or two.
I
don't think they're going to buy anyone.
Dan Greenwald actually came out and was asked the same question, too, about another Forza series. And he said a few things. He said, one, he does, and he was not asked specifically about platforms or anything like that or what kind of game. He says he does not see a limit on what platform they could make games on, so PC, and he does not see a limit on the disciplines they could make a game for, so rally or anything like that.
But you gotta say what he really said, though. He was like, and just to clarify, I am not saying there's gonna be another Forza game.
Because he's not gonna announce a game. He was being very, very
adamant about, like, there's not gonna be another fucking type of Forza game next year. Like, it's not happening. Like, he was being very clear about it.
Well, at last E3, they also came out and said there's a possibility the third Forza franchise.
Well,
he said a
comment to do with it being in like the next decade, though. I
mean, no, he didn't say anything about that. He didn't say that. He just said he doesn't see a limit, but that it's not happening. He didn't say it's not happening. He said he's not announcing anything. And if it does happen, they'll announce it when it comes up to it. Like, it's just, the possibility is open, but we're not saying anything is actually happening. And that's basically what Dan said. He didn't actually give any kind of time frame or anything like that. Anyway, I mean, it's a conversation over nothing, because whether or not they're going to do anything else, it's up to them. I think Phil is being very open to allowing the studios do what they really want to do. Like, he came out and he said that it wasn't Phil's decision or first party's decision to make the Halo maps free. That was 343 Studios' decision. Just like it was Turn 10's decision to make the racetracks free in Forza 5. So I think he's allowing much more freedom for the studios themselves to decide on what they're going to do next.
And but not ridiculous Sony-style freedom.
Not ridiculous, but, you know. They have freedom.
Yeah, I mean, I think the main sort of ones he was talking about, I mean, obviously you've got your Forza Workshop, your Gears Workshop, and your Halo Workshop, but I think the rest of them don't so much have a franchise that's that big. I mean, I think they've wobbled. Fable could have been that, but they kind of wobbled with it. But I think he's just sort of saying, you know, if the rest of them have got ideas, then, you know, I'll let them do that. So.
But I thought Microsoft had all the developers chained up. Like on Saw.
Oh, gaff. Yeah, that's it. It isn't even worth talking about that. Not even getting started on it.
So, Phantom Dust, guys.
Phantom Dust gonna be great. Another $5 million.
I hope it doesn't become the Xbox's Last Guardian.
We already talked about Phantom Dust early in the show.
Doesn't take that long.
Did we?
Yes, we did. I brought it up.
Oh, that's right. It wasn't a separate news story. It was just kind of mixed in, huh?
Yeah.
We have no other news on the 100th show.
What do you want? You mean to make up news? Microsoft buys Nintendo. Confirmed.
Yes.
Check it out now. It's happening.
There's a new preview update. that came out last night. It seems like it did improve some backwards compatibility performance for me and Dustin, at least.
Yes, definitely.
Yeah.
Yeah, I felt like there was a little bit of input lag, especially on two games in particular, in Perfect Dark Zero and Geometry Wars. And after this update, it feels like it's gone. So
awesome.
That's good news.
The thing about backwards compatibility that has me interested is what it could do for competitive fighting games. Because assuming they make it so that it has no lag in terms of input, you could see Street Fighter 4 potentially, maybe. You could see definitely like the digital games like Street Fighter 3 Third Strike and maybe Marvel vs. Capcom, but that would take a lot of negotiating with Disney, so I don't know. But if they do that, then they might have a way to keep the Xbox competitive in fighting games, because people still play Marvel vs. Capcom 3 a lot. Uh-huh. But again, like those games, they cannot sell those games anymore because of Disney's, in my opinion, short-sighted decision to not let Capcom work on those games anymore after they purchased Marvel. Because every Marvel thing that's come out in video game form since then has been mobile and terrible. So,
did we talk about the new, there is a piece of news that came out, Dying Light's new Drink Water for DLC campaign. If you take a picture of yourself drinking a glass of water, tag your picture with hashtag drink for DLC, they'll give you a code for DLC in Dying Light.
Which is ironic, considering that DLC was kind of...
Yeah.
Locked behind pre-orders, well. Yes.
Hey, man, look, they're taking advantage of the situation. You can't really blame them.
Bandwagon.
Yeah. No, publicity.
Did we discuss Destiny?
Not yet. No. Let's get to it.
Destiny's more... Oh.
Red Bull time.
I did a little bit.
Jesus Christ.
Everyone drink your verification can.
All right, look, it's we got more ground than just Red rules Bull, on the show, okay? Destiny rants... I'm allowing 5 minutes, okay? Rants for 5 minutes. General discussions is always locked at 2.
I think Michael should be the one to tell us the news, though.
Michael, I'm giving you 5, maybe even 7 full minutes to rant about Destiny. Maybe 7.
If you go over that, we're playing.
Gotta explain it to us like we don't know what's going on, though.
Yeah, like I'm an idiot. No, that's always true.
Officially announced at E3 this year was Destiny's next expansion, The Taken King, which is promising to have the most content of any of the expansions, a whole new patrol area, even focusing on Oryx, the god of the Hive, and his race, The Taken. He killed his son in the last raid, so he's kind of angry, believe it or not. But the issue with it is that just the expansion is $40, which is a fair amount. That is a lot. And it's not like a doubling of content. It's a lot of content, but it's not a whole lot of content. And so $40 seems like a fair amount. But the big issue comes with the Collector's Edition. The Collector's Edition is $80, but it also includes the base game of Destiny and the two previous expansions, which originally, well, right now, because you can't get the pre-order version of it, is $100. You're instead getting it for $80. So you're saving money by buying the Collector's Edition. Now the issue comes where people are saying, I don't get the Collector's Edition stuff for any amount of a price. I can't buy it separately or anything like that, because there's actually some stuff people wanted in the Collector's Edition. Exotic class items being the big thing, which means they would have effects and stuff, and they looked very cool. We have seen them before. So Bungie has an interview with Luke Plunkett being the talking, and he basically says, you're going to see this cool stuff, you're going to buy it because we know you're going to buy it. Basically coming off as a giant asswipe. This displeases the Destiny community, who has been very supportive of the game, regardless of how much flack the game has received. I am included in that, although I haven't been very loud, and haha, Destiny is incredible, I've just been playing it a lot.
You're a hardcore fan, yeah.
I checked my time, it was 1,500 hours.
Let's take a minute for the time lost.
So,
Minute's not over. This isn't going against you.
You're one of these, right?
Poor one. So Bungie goes, okay, we kind of fucked up a little bit. We'll let you purchase this additional content for $20. The previous expansions, which have been raids, full sets of gear, new zones, new quests, have been $20. This is three emblems, three shaders, three class items, and three emotes, which, granted, the emotes, that's a pretty cool thing. But $20. They have not improved their reputation with the Destiny community whatsoever. On top of that, they said, oh, people who have had level 30 characters from this point on, you're going to get a really cool-looking shader as appreciation. So far and away, there have been, this is how you officially quit Destiny guides going up. I personally haven't touched the game in a while because I realized I just don't need to. It was the same thing that happened to me when I decided to quit World of Warcraft. It's like, why am I even bothering?
So,
yep. That happens with every MMO I've ever played. So, long story short, people aren't happy. I'm not going to bother playing. I'm not going to bother picking up the Taken King unless they give it to me for free. Even though
this man's put in 1,500 hours mm-hmm. Destiny.
Even though the content that they're adding looks incredible. All the new subclasses look great. As a Titan, I freaked out on Twitter about the new subclass because I'm going to have a ranged super. I'm going to be able to kill you and not be near you. As a Titan, that's incredible. So it's a case of Luke was right in that, yeah, people are going to buy it, but I'm not going to buy it. And a lot of people who put a lot of time into Destiny also aren't going to buy it.
I heard the DLC was going to add the lore of Lord of the Rings and Star Wars. Is this true? No.
Oh, and on top of that, they said there's a mission that's only going to be available under Red Bull cans starting at 7-Elevens. It's like in July they're going to start, and then in August it'll be at all stores. And then when it launches, this mission will come out. But luckily, it'll be available for everybody
for free,
January 1st. Yeah, for free. Yeah. So it's basically early access to a mission for drinking a Red Bull, which, it's not a big deal to me.
It's a Red Bull timed exclusive.
So, it's a weird thing to lock content behind, but yeah, it's not that big of a deal.
Look, we talked about it earlier. I think locking content behind tap water is ingenious, and you have to contact your public utility.
So Chaos Dash asks,
except for California.
Yeah, yeah, poor
Dash
California.
Asks if we think that this is Bungie's doing or Activision's doing.
Yes, it's Bungie.
I think it's both.
It's Bungie. The thing is, the other part of the interview that the interviewer brought up was that, like, his the whole value perception thing actually came around before Luke Smith put his foot in it, was that it's $40, but also it's £40. I mean, you don't need the currency converter to tell you that's wrong. So he was sort of talking about how actually we're getting sort of incredibly poor value for money over here. And then, you know, he sort of proceeded to move on with talking about the different collector's editions and how expensive it was. And then he just further put his foot on it. So, but I mean, I think this is all Bungie. I don't know. There's just something about them and the way that, you know, all these people that have been there for a long time seem to be leaving and how they don't have sort of good things to say about them. Like, I think that, you know, they got paid and not realizing that generally they didn't make a game that was all that great. But they got paid.
People are leaving Bungie. I did not know that.
Well, so many of them have left over the years. I mean, was it when, after Marty O'Donnell got fired, was it Jason Griesemer, who was one of the ex-Halo leads, and one of the others said to him, Destiny, by the makers of Halo, that we didn't fire. You know, so it's, you know, it definitely doesn't seem like, you know, Joe Staten left as well. You know, there's been tons of other people that have left Bungie, and it doesn't seem like it's, you know, a particularly good ship over there, generally.
Yeah. I was going to say, I wouldn't say that this is just Activision's fault, unless you see people leaving Bungie. You know, if people are leaving Bungie, then I might agree that it might not be all Bungie. You know, if people are against this, because I wouldn't want to be working on something like that. You know, I mean, their vision completely changed. I mean, what we were promised in the beginning wasn't what they gave us in the first place, and that was bad enough. I mean, as an artist, as you know, somebody who creates things, I would be so ticked if I was promised that this is what we were working on, and then now this is what's going to happen. Man, I would not want to work there.
I agree with Nigel. Sorry.
All right, I know it's going to be a few seconds for everybody to see, but Steve, I hope you watch the Twitch channel, because I just added a little something to your... People were getting confused, so I had to add it.
Yeah.
What happened to...
What?
Can anybody hear me? No. Everything's going down. What happened to the internet? Are you still there, Jason?